No.
Okay.
How much gear do you think a player should be able to choose? What's the thing? What are the things you think they need to be able to choose? Defining gear such as?
Well, like our friend is not
signature gear.
He's he made this crazy ass little goblin who is essentially Indiana Jones.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Okay.
I mean, literally, he is.
Right. Okay.
You know, so he's got stuff. You know, he's got stuff that all adventurers are going to have. You're going to have rope. You're going to have, you know, some light emitting something. You're going to have, you know, but you know, he's got his hat. He's got his whip. He's got a straight razor. I'll cut you!
Yeah.
That the aforementioned horrors, he was running around and getting with, you know? So, stuff like that. You know, like my drink. He's got his beast kid cooking gear.
Right. But beyond that, you don't really care.
Again, the standard adventurer stuff. I've got
one. Okay.
I've got Bob. He knows he's a drink. But you know what I mean?
Sure.
Yeah, we always play with adventuring gear in brackets.
Okay.
Okay.
As long as it's generic, doesn't really provide you a bonus.
Every time you get short, you carry it.
Yeah. The old backpack.
Okay. Hypothetical system time. Let's just say hypothetically that your characters were allowed one or two pieces of signature gear. You're playing the game. You get to choose one or two pieces. Everything else is chosen for you. This is only for major gear. Incidental gear isn't even dealt with in the system. It's just narrative. It makes sense that I contain this in my pocket right now. It makes sense that he has that. How many people in the room would like that system?
Depends
on?
I mean, your signature gear, I mean, if it's going to be, this is the only thing that you get to choose.
That was just what I said.
Right.
Yeah, it is only the thing you get to choose.
That's
yeah.
It. Then there needs to be a good, healthy dollop of personalization into it. So it makes it your personal gear.
Okay, now that system with the option as a character to choose character options that allow you more choices.
I don't want to spend more choices for the right to get gear. Well, money is boring games.
Right. Now, think about that in Spycraft. This is an espionage game where you answer to a higher authority.
Right.
Exactly.
Right.
Exactly. I'm dating Money Penny.
Yeah,
you know, she's this. Yeah.
You got
phasers
for
that
you're paying.
But every character should have some form of that.
Every character gets a few choices, one or two, however many, and you have to basically stretch your resources to do more.
Dating Money Penny. Well, the techie isn't going to do that, but maybe he knows the RP guys. Every character should have some option to increase their gear options in a unique way, I guess, not just.
It'd be a feat or something like that. Because, like, when we played, we played, I can't remember what it was. It was either Mage or it was a Memoriam game. And one of the stats, because it was technocracy, one of the stats was gear. And because you worked for them and you could, you know, hey, I've got, you know, three in this background. Okay, cool. Well, you can get a hold of this.
But you had to spend character resources to increase that stat.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay.
Or get the better gear.
But you had a. But there was always a floor for people who didn't want to bother with it.
I should point out that in this hypothetical system, no one the guy that had no choices would still be getting a choice or two, and nobody would be getting inferior gear. The idea is simply to leverage choice as a character mechanic, and the idea is that some people like to choose gear, a lot of people don't. That's what we're hearing. So we're wondering whether or not that's
if they haven't chosen the right gear and you know they're going to need, you know, these items.
That's the other question from 2.0 where people are like, all right, and so agents, now you're going to jump out of an airplane, and it's gonna be like, I don't have any vehicle picks. And so the jump instructor's like, boot. You know? End of campaign. You know.
That should really never happen,
yeah,
right?
Exactly.
Yeah. Okay. Anything else on gear, or do we want to jump to the next?
I don't think so.
What else? Any other things that people... Again, everybody gets one choice. One thing you never want to see again.
I don't know if it's not what I want to see again, but again, from what we were
sense on the point buy value to build the race. But at the same time, you look at it and you're like,
are you saying that you want races that break the point buys because they're more powerful?
Or, I don't know, it's just sometimes it just doesn't, I mean, you look at it and you go, well, that doesn't make sense, until you look at the math behind it and you go, oh, okay, it's, you know, there it lays out, they cancel, but at the same time, you look at it from the race.
Right, right.
He's not happy because it's dragon.
No, but
but you can play a dragon at first level.
Yeah, there is that, yeah.
Right. You know, yeah, some of those feats can be really cool, but you know, in daylight, abiding darkness.
Oh, okay, actually, this one we've got solved. So, how many people here want a build your own species product?
Yeah, absolutely. Cool.
Yes.
That one's in the pipeline.
Right.
Because it's just one of those things where it's like, you know, you look at it and you're like, does it really, you know, make sense sometimes?
Right.
So something to replace the choose your species study character creation. Like, sure, you don't play a Drake. Here's these 50 million parts that you can change it and I'll GM for many. Mm-hmm. Or is it a GM build your species?
It depends on how you want to do it.
Yeah.
I think
like, I mean, if you play a world where, you know, storm giants are getting it on with halflings, okay, you can make a storm halfling. It's very awkward. Don't imagine it. It's like the corgi Malamute interbreed.
Yeah, it involves
like
a funnel.
How did that happen?
Yeah.
So the... wow.
I wasn't the one who brought it up.
But I'm saying if you...
I'm really good at spiking, man. Don't put that kind of thing in front of me.
So, you know, I mean, that sort of thing. So you can put it in players' hands. But the my opinion is that the more balanced experience will probably be that the GM is either approving them ahead of time or making some calls or generating races that make sense for the world. It's part of the homebrew building, you know.
I think it's more than non-humanoid races like Roofwalkers and Drakes, maybe even some kinds of giants, which... More species-style options for them make sense, but, you know, like a human with pointy ears and this kind of thing, okay, they're an elf, or they have elf heritage or something. Mm-hmm. Do they need 50 million types of, you know, drow? Probably not. Different types of dragons? Well, in gaming and in fantasy literature, there are hundreds of different options that people are just expecting to kind of be there. So saying that I'm a red dragon, okay, you're ready to breathe fire.
Right.
Right, right.
Okay.
Okay.
I think specifically you're referencing, like, it isn't like the cold-blooded aspect of the drink.
Right.
Well, that's it just doesn't, in my brain, it just doesn't... I know why.
Yeah.
You know, because I can do the math.
Right.
Like, well, if you get rid of this, you get rid of this, then go away, and
then
go away.
Yeah, then you lose your wings or something like that.
Well,
so.
It's the breath weapon, really.
Yeah.
The breath weapon loses beast and...
Sure.
There you go.
Yeah. Okay.
According to the forum math.
Right. Yeah. Yeah.
But you know, this is one of those. It's just like really. So.
Well, every character option has to be printed in ink, and so we have to make choices when we're putting them together. You know, and they're not going to fit everybody's idea. So there's a lot of things in Fantasycraft that are not the way that I perceive fantasy to be in my world.
Right.
But, what we want to do, why I said we're doing that build your own species product, the idea is it's a toolkit. People need to be able to build the elves that are right for them and the drakes that are right for them.
Yeah, so if you want to build your own, like, you know, basic D&D elf, you could do it and, you know, push the gift feat directly into the species, but you'd have to might give up your sharp hearing or something like that,
right.
You know. It's all a trade-off.
Right.
But it's not, we've talked about this for quite a while. So,
yeah.
Yeah.
This product's been in the pipeline since the beginning of the Fantasycraft, really. Mm-hmm. Okay, anybody else want to put something on the chopping block?
Attribute numbers.
I like attribute modifiers.
Attribute numbers.
Numbers, attribute numbers.
In your face, Flag.
Yeah. I never defended them. Oh, wow.
I had two rants on the way here. One of them was vitality, and the other one was attribute numbers.
And attribute numbers was one I didn't actually argue with you.
Has recently dumped theirs, and after I saw that, I said, it makes perfect sense.
Who did?
M&M3.
Yeah, M&M3 did.
It's like,
yeah.
There's no point to that number.
Yeah, it's just an extra step. I completely agree with you.
The bonus is what everyone cares about.
The range is arbitrary. Yeah, it's...
You can call it 1,000 to 5,000. It doesn't matter.
It wasn't arbitrary when you were rolling 3d6.
Yes, 25 years ago.
That's what I'm saying.
We're not, it's just, we're not still printing on dot matrix printers. We shouldn't be using attribute.
Thanks, Grandpa.
Can we get a generator hooked to his eyes?
I could power this whole building sometimes. So, yeah.
Yeah. All right.
Okay, so.
I think we're almost done. Does anybody want to get anything else into the hatchet before we leave?
It's going to be, you guys have to hate some more stuff, right?
Really?
Well, since it's been brought up.
Yeah.
Sorry?
Since it's been brought up, not rolling attributes.
Yeah, you like rolling attributes, huh?
I like rolling attributes.
Oh, really? You like rolling attributes?
There are some burnings of point by life, but I do not like the graduated 5 at that
point. Really?
Too many players sacrifice too much to get that 16 and all their other stats are 10 or 8 or whatever.
Huh. Yeah, it's like, interesting.
It's like you don't choose for your character to be less than this one attribute, but you want to be good at this one. You have to. So it's not for role-playing reasons, for a purely stat-based reason. Yeah.
Right.
You want to be smart for role-playing reasons, but you don't want to be less than these other ones.
At some point, you can't argue with the mechanics. If you want to be really good at this,
not as good as that, yeah. And I mean, you can, even with point by, if you stop at 16, it's 16, 14, 12, 12, 12, 10. So you do take 1 10, you know, and you're getting a 16 out of it.
Not very wise.
Hmm?
He's not very wise.
Okay, so you like rolling attributes.
So rolling attributes.
Not necessarily rolling them. I talk about my system. We use cards. Everybody has the same total.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so there's not the splatter of, you know, this guy sucks.
So the deep extremes don't bother you so much?
Having somebody who rolls really well and somebody who rolls crappy. Thank you.
That's
every year they follow us around.
Cards is where you get the same cards, and everybody has the same total, basically. But where they fall out is
right. The reason for the you don't like the gradual incline in cost is right. What you said earlier, and of course that's there to prevent people from distributing themselves with a bunch of 18s with
Okay.
It's a tough problem.
Yeah.
Anything else on the block?
I think you just would never miss. Like, how do people feel about untrained checks? Love them? Hate them?
I like generally having the chance to do things, even if you suck at it. You know, anyone can throw a dart at a board.
Right? Do you want to tell a player no, you can't even try?
Which is do you feel that skill untrained checks do that?
No, but I guess it wasn't clear the question.
Oh, he's asking whether you feel that untrained checks are something that should be on the block. Are they something that you use?
I like
yes.
There are some things that don't make quite as much sense. You know, like your astrophysicist untrained check is, you know, probably not so good. But
right,
you know,
it could be like Shadowrun or D&D, where you have some skills that you cannot use untrained.
Yeah,
right.
I mean, that doesn't.
Like, you should not be able to use demolitions untrained.
Wow, I've had firecrackers before. No, I have. What was the movie where they got? Oh, it's Die Hard. That's an untrained demolitions check.
Yeah.
Stick all the detonators in, kick it down, tie it to a monitor, kick it down to the elevator shaft. That's every one of my players right there, except they'd probably ride it all the way down.
Oh, this will be awesome.
I've got 3 action dice. This
on
is no problem.
On top of a garbage can lid. Yeah.
I saw this in Jackass once. Yeah, it's another thing heard at my table pretty commonly.
Your next campaign.
Yeah.
Jackass the RPG.
That will have high vitality progression.
In the revision you guys did the fantasy draft, where you took out, like, say, dwarves can't swim, well, you changed that.
Right.
That was good. Mm-hmm. Okay? But, like,
right. When I'm referring more to the caps, the cap of 15.
Right. Yeah. Right now in Fantasy Craft, we have untrained checks that cap you at 15 and increase your error range by 2.
As long as all of the DCs for specific things you can do for every single skill always take that into account. Like even Saga Edition, you can't make trained knowledge checks, or you can't get expert information with a DC 20 or higher unless you're trained.
you just flat out can't do it. That kind of bugged me.
Well, and that's also true in Fantasy Craft.
That's what the question is.
Because you're capped at 15.
There are lots of things that are DC 20 that people may want to try, and that if they're not trained, they can't actually achieve that without a decent. And if they don't have a good action die roll or a significant amount of luck, they're never going to be able to do it. So
maybe some other numeric modifier for being untrained, but actually hard capping, maybe not. I don't know what the suggestion is.
Well, and that's the question. I'm not looking for a suggestion on how to solve, but I was curious if people, if you've ever had players hit even the 15 cap, which is much more lenient than it was in 2.0 and stuff.
It was a high level. Yeah.
Right, you'll hit it and you'll stop at 15.
Yeah. Well,
you know, I'm a guy who's level 20 and yet I can't change the oil in my car. I'm a super spy who's like, ooh, carjack. What do I do with that? You know. Sure, I can pick up the car, but I cannot change the wheel.
With your mind.
Yeah, exactly.
What if you just added your adventure level to the top of the cap? Just flat out. Your 20th level.
Right. I mean, and that's one way to do it. We've had graded caps before.
It's, yeah, it's another calculation.
It's just another thing. It's just another thing that says no. Yeah. But that's the question. That's what people have tended to force us away from caps in the past.
I see it either way. I mean,
okay.
I like it either way. You know, I see where, you know, having a cap, you're just, well, I guess you'd be really stupid lucky, but that's what adventure dice are, right?
Action dice, yeah, they help, yeah.
Sorry.
Except you only get one most times.
Well, you say you've seen situations where you might use it. Uh-huh. So what about a floating cap system where the GM can just apply caps whenever he wanted?
Sure.
As long as there's an option.
Yeah.
Well, the situation I'm talking about is a spellcaster without a kit. I started a con scenario like that where everybody starts shackling and they don't have their stuff. And, you know, that was just a challenge that I thought was important for that particular scene to make it, you know, interesting. Uh-huh. I don't think if the spellcaster still had his full array of abilities with him, then it would have taken me out.
I teleport us out. Yeah. Poof. Right. Okay.
I have one
and
last
that may
one
be
before
something
I think
to do with kits rather than caps. We kind of tied them together.
The caps, I found that allow certain kits that might be a little more difficult, but make more sense.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So.
Okay.
What about proficiencies? How many times do they actually come into play?
I'm sorry.
Proficiencies. How often do they actually impact your game?
How often do people try to use something they're not proficient with? How often does that happen?
Occasionally.
Depends
on your plot.
Lots of dishonor or anchor. That's true.
Well, I think it's more.
I find they like the abundance of them. They like to spend them on tricks.
Right.
Unarmed, right?
Yeah, exactly.
You know, I've got my unarmed, and I've got forte, and then the rest are tricks.
Yeah.
Anything else on character sheets that you guys have noticed like that that just never gets used?
Never comes into play.
More space.
Well, we're going to start printing at 2-point,
yes.
And you can read it with a microscope.
Fantasy Craft, or it's Spycraft 3rd Edition will come with a little micro.
Micro dot. The only game you have to play with an electron microscope.
Yeah.
But it's all one side, and I have an illustration. How many of you like the Fantasy Craft character sheet? 4 pages.
Love it.
How many of you don't like it? I see some skeptical. Oh, don't like. Why don't you like it?
I don't like the way that it splits up combat, non-combat feats. I want all your feats in one box.
Okay.
Yeah, the way it's set up. I mean, all the stuff that's on there is great, but where it's laid out is...
Would that problem be solved, out of curiosity, if there was one feat section that broke it up into combat and non-combat feats?
Yeah.
Okay. Mark, what about you?
Exactly.
Same thing. You didn't like this combat, non-combat.
It's just finding.
I thought that was such
a
good idea.
I did too.
When they look for a certain thing, they're like, oh, it's like, and they run out of space really fast. Especially the tricks and they run out of space.
Does tricks, feats, racial abilities, class abilities, they kind of all occupy kind of the same area that she's from?
In your face, Black.
What?
Remember how I was telling you that in practice, all those things that we call all those things, they're all one thing.
No, okay.
I didn't argue with that. God. Whatever. He's eager to make me the bad guy now. I'm trying to justify your insane rage.
No, I'm just proving myself right.
You don't have to prove yourself right.
All right. I think we're good. Thank you guys for coming.
Anybody on the forums signed up for the awkward games? A lot of you in that category.
Right.
I had a post on the forum on a Spycraft game.
Scion, by the way. Yeah.